Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to get started at 6 o'clock. We've got a very, very full program. Just to acquaint you with it, we're going to have keynote presentations by our three speakers here. We're very happy to welcome Councillor Kazunori Yamamoto from the Personal Information Protection Commission. My very, very good friend from Korea, former dean of the law school at Keio University, Professor Nohyoung, but also an internationally respected expert on internet legal policy issues. And he's going to talk about privacy today, but he works across the field. And then a person I've known now for about a year, who's really in the center of things in Washington, Michael Panzera, who's with the International Affairs Office. This is the sixth forum that we've done. And I'm really excited about it because, you know, one of my jobs is to kind of look at these presentations as they come in and try to see if they make sense. And today, I think we really have a very, very well put together group of presentations. So, Councillor Yamamoto actually is going to give us some details about the kinds of issues, but also some of the decisions and thinking that are going on within the PPC as it develops an implementation framework for the new law. Professor Park, Korea is going through enormous changes right now as they try to put together a legal framework for privacy and for cybersecurity. And a lot of the work is being done through legislation. And there are positive and negative aspects about that. In that respect, there is a bit of a contrast with what Japan is doing. Japan has a broad framework law, but the actual details are being put together by Yamamoto-san and his team. Finally, we have Mike Panzera with the International Office of the FTC. I asked him to talk about IoT because, you know, when we talk about personal information and privacy, one of the big issues is whether there is any personal information and whether there is any privacy in the world of IoT. And Mike and the staff at FTC are beginning to try to create some definitions and some guidelines in that particular area. So I just thought, wow, this is a really, really good, really good combination. So I'm going to ask each of them to speak for 15 minutes. And then we've put together a multi-stakeholder panel, people that work on privacy issues all day long from a variety of different perspectives. And we're going to try to have a very, very interactive conversation with them, with our speakers, but also with you. As I look out in that audience right now, I see Andrew and I see Kenta and I see, Kato-san and others. We got real experts sitting out there as well. So I don't want to have a dividing line between people that are sitting here up front or around the tables, and you there. In that context, with the multi-stakeholder discussion, I'm going to try to, as the moderator, drive discussion in some of these areas. These are not new issues, but it's very interesting. I think one of the things that we want to look at tonight is, are there gaps? Or are there convergences between the way in which the U.S., for example, is defining personal information with respect to rules governing data localization? So we want to step back a little bit and begin to put this in a three-country context. And if you think about the way the situation is here in Asia, I just returned last night from China. I spoke at the Internet Society of China on issues related to the sharing economy. China is very interested in security and privacy because without security and privacy, you can't have the trust that is really fundamental to the sharing economy. And so the kinds of decisions and the kinds of frameworks that we come up with between the three countries, which are really leaders economically and in the technological area, are going to have a huge influence on China and other countries in the region. So it's important that we get it right. So. We'll be working through these. We finish up at 8 o'clock, and I encourage you all to stay for coffee afterwards. for 30 minutes. It's, I think we look upon these forums as an opportunity to discuss issues, but also for all of us to get to know each other better. So thank you very much for coming, and I'd like to turn it over to Councillor Yamamoto.
こんにちは。個人情報保護委員会事務局参事官の山本でございます。スイッチを入れてくださいという指示がされておりましたので、これで大丈夫でしょうか。はい。改めまして、個人情報委員会事務局参事官山本でございます。今日は、個人情報保護法の改正法の施行に向けた状況につきまして、 簡単に皆さんにご報告をさせていただきたいと思います。本日は、私の他に個人情報保護委員会事務局からも何人か私と予算させていただいておりますので、まあ、どんなご質問が出ても私は答えられなければ私どもの同僚職員もしっかり答えてくれると思いますので、何だとおっしゃっていただければと思います。 で、本日は、個人情報委員会におけます、改正個人情報保護法によりまして、政令ないしは委員会規則解法令におきまして、検討が委ねられている事項につきましての、委員会での検討の状況について簡単にご報告をさせていただきたいと思います。 主な項目はこの5項目プラスその他ということでございます。で、2ページはこれは確認のためのものでございますけれども、キャビネットオーダー政令に改正法に基づきまして具体的な詳細を示すことを委ねられている事項がこの2ページのリストで示されております。 で、まあ、参考の部分には、国会その他における改正法を審議、ないしは議論させていただいたときのやり取りにつきまして、簡単に記載もさせていただいております。このうち、まあ、国会等での主な議論があったものについて、まあ、具体的に申しますと、一番上の個人識別符号の定義の部分、また、その次の要配慮個人情報の定義、 の部分、こちらにつきましての後ほど委員会の検討状況について、お時間をいただいてご説明したいと思います。で、この次のページが委員会規則、私ども個人情報保護委員会で規則を作ります、中身につきまして、これを改正法に基づいて検討を委任されている部分を一覧にしたものでございます。 でここにつきましても、まあ、国会等での主な議論がございました。欄で言いますと、上から3つ目の外国にある第三者への提供制限に関する新たな記載につきましての検討状況、またその次の第三者提供にかかる今回新たに導入いたします確認記録義務に関するルール、でまた最後でございますけれども、その下の匿名加工情報 の加工基準等につきまして、後ほどご説明させていただきたいと思います。まずは個人情報の定義の明確化ということで、個人識別符号のところからお話を申し上げていきたいと思います。こちら、4ページとしてお示ししておりますのは、個人情報保護法の現行法の条文が一番上に書いてありまして、その下に全面施行時とありますけれども、今後 おそらく平成29年中に施行していくことになる、この改正個人情報保護法の改正条文が施行された、タイミングでこう変わりますということが示されております。で、ここで、申し上げたいのは2点でございまして、 1点は基本的にこの個人情報法上の個人情報の定義については変更はございません。拡張したり狭めたりということはないということは従来申し上げております。で、今回新たに入ったのがこの第2条の第項2号、関数字の2、個人識別符号が含まれるものということで、従来の個人情報の定義の中で 個人識別符号を、まあ、その身体的特徴をデータにしたもの、これはもう私の山本という名前は分からなくても、この特定の個人だということが分かる、データであるということでありまして、これを、個人識別符号というふうにするわけなんですけれども、そういったものは個人情報でありますということを明確にしましょうというような措置であります。 この2号、アラビア数字の2の下の関数字の1番下のパラグラフのところに書いてあるのが、身体的特徴をデータ化したもの以外に個人に固有に割り振られている番号符号といったものについても個人識別符号ということで位置づけるというようなことがこの個人情報法の改正において求まれております。 で、これらにつきましてどのようなものを位置づけていくか、これを政令で規定していくわけなんですけれども、個人情報保護委員会においてご議論いただいている内容でございます。このまず、丸1、第1号個人識別符号関係と書いてございますのが、これが身体的特徴をデジタルデータとしたものであります。 こういったものを、方向性としてはこういったここに掲げてあるものが含まれるということなのではないか、一つはDNA、ゲノムに関するデータというのが含まれるのではないか、で、その次指紋とか肛門ですね、手のひら、こういったものを含まれるのではないか、また いろいろなものに映り込むこの静脈ですね、静脈、こういったものも含まれるのではないか、あとは歩く形、模様でございますとか、声紋、声の特徴、こういったものも含まれるのではないかというような方向性を委員会でご審議いただいております。これらの内容につきまして、デジタルデータ化したものにつきましては、 個人情報保護法に基づきます個人識別符号として関連し取り扱うべきではないかというのが丸1番のところです。で、丸2番がこの身体的特徴ではなくて、個人に固有に一つ割り振られているような番号が特徴付けられるようなものであります。で、これは個人番号、まあ、カタカナでマイナンバーと書かせていただいておりますけれども、 一人に一つ、準備下の番号、皆さん、割り振られておると思いますし、マイナンバーカードも積極的にご申請いただいて、ご活用いただきたいと思いますけれども、こういったものは入ってくるのではないか、それ以外に公的保険の番号、こういったものもそういったものとして入ってくるのではないか、というようなことで、このあたりを列挙させていただいているものでございます。 これらが個人情報保護委員会でお示しいただいている方向性でございまして、これを踏まえて、現在、政令の条文の策定を、私ども個人情報委員会事務局と、内閣法制局におきまして行っているところということでございます。次が、要配慮個人情報、センシティブデータでございます。 センシティブデータにつきましては、一般的な個人情報と違って丁寧に取り扱いましょうというようなことでありますけれども、条文についてはこの7ページの一番上に書いてございます。で、要配慮個人情報に、もう改正個人情報法の条文上含まれるものというのはここに列挙されております。人種、心情、 社会的身分、病歴、犯罪の経歴、犯罪により害を被った事実、犯罪被害を受けた事実ですね。 こういったものは、要配慮個人情報ですということはもう改正法において明確になっております。でこれに加えて、ちょっと読み上げると長いのですけれども、不当な差別偏見その他の不利益が生じないようにその取り扱いに特に配慮を要するものとして政令で定める記述、この今しっかり英語で訳していただいて相当心配なんですけれども、政令で定める記述をこの要配慮個人情報に含むことになっておりまして、これらのものとしてはその下に書いてございます、こちらの方を、含める方法なのではないかということで委員会で今ご議論いただいております。一つは、法律上病歴が含まれて要配慮個人情報として位置づけられておりますが、このような病歴に準ずるものとして例えば括弧1丸1のローマ数字ちっちゃい小文字数字の1でありますけれども、診療情報といったものはそういったものに含まれるのではないかと、次に健康診断の結果といったものも含まれてくるのではないか、これは病気健康状態を推認させるという意味において、同じグループのようにご理解いただけると思います。で3番目として障害ですね、こういうものの状況についても要配慮個人情報として含めるということで政令に規定するのではないかなということであります。で4番目ゲノム情報とありますけれども、こちらもその、ゲノムについても現在のまた将来にわたっての健康についての情報を含むものということになりますので、病歴に準ずるものとしてこれら4つが含まれるのではないかというのが一つのグループです。でもう一つのグループが犯罪の経歴に準ずるものということになっておりまして、これは犯罪の経歴に準ずるものとして犯罪の経歴にはなっていないんだけれども、すなわち有罪とはなっていないんだけれども逮捕されましたというような刑事手続きにかかった事実、こちらについてはこの丸2のその括弧1ですね、ローマ数字の1として刑事手続きを受けた事実というのはこれにやはり準ずるものなのではないか、合わせてこれは我が国の犯罪構成の構造上そうなっているわけなんですけれども、少年犯罪については別途の枠組みになっております。よってもってその次の2番でありますけれども、少年の非行事実のようなものについてはやはり犯罪の経歴に準ずるものということになるのではないかなというような整理がここにお示しさせていただいております。であと政令につきましてはもう一つちょっと詳細になりますけれども、要配慮個人情報の取得の時に本人同意の例外を政令で定めることになっております。これは要配慮個人情報というのは、やむを得ない場合に本人の同意なく要配慮個人情報を取得することができます。これは例えば緊急事態であるとかこういうものがいくつか法律で定められているわけなんですけれども、それの例外の場合として例えばこの各国の丸一に書いてございますのは、身体的な障害がこう外形上明らかになっているような場合にこういったものを例えばカメラで撮ったデータとして取り込んだような時にそれを一つ一つこの、本人のご同意をいただくというのは実務的には大変な負担になる一方で、その利益は何なのかということがやや疑問ということになります。よってもってそういったものは外形上明らかなものについての取得については本人の同意のやっぱり例外ということになるのではないかなということが丸1で書いてあります。で丸2に書いてございますのはこれはもうさらにまた法技術的なんですが、第三者提供個人情報第三者提供をする際にこれを委託先に個人情報を提供するのは第三者提供に当たらないというのが個人情報保護法上の枠組みになっております。これと同様の整理をここでしておかないと、要配慮個人情報については取得について同意を得ることが必要になりますので、ここで、委託について同じ整理をしておかないと非対称法制度上義務内容の非対称が生じるということでここに記載しております。 で、次が匿名加工情報についてのことです。これは委員会規則で定めていく内容になります。これは個人を識別することができないような形で加工をする基準ということになります。でこれが加工に関する基準ということで、このページで言えば、丸1しかないですけど、この丸1で書いてあるんですね。で、その「い」で書いてあるところなんですけれども、ここの部分については前回、この、フォーラムでも議論、匿名加工情報については、辛口のコメントも含めていただきましたけれども、別に異議を指す必要ないんですけれども、この規則については、あらゆる個人情報の、匿名加工の方法について、ウィニーリ際にわたり、また網羅的にこれを示していくのはもう難しいということはもう明らかでございますので、一般的な皆さんがこう必ずやっていただく共通する手法について、定めるというような方向性でこの規則は定めたいと思っております。で、具体的にこの匿名加工情報を作っていくにあたっては、さらにその個人情報の特性に応じて、個人の識別ができないような形での加工というものを施す必要がありますので、こういったものについては例えば認定個人情報保護団体が作成するような個人情報指針、または各企業がまた各企業なしは企業グループにおいて、検討される自主ルールといったものに、詳細の検討実施の催促は委ねていきたいと思っております。で、その実践にあたりましてはですね、前回も私から申し上げましたけども、個人情報委員会としてこの新しい制度の活用にあたりまして、しっかりご相談あればご協力、それに応えていきたいというふうに考えております。そういったこともありまして、ガイドライン、またはここに書いてございますような事務局レポート、スタッフレポートのようなものも、積極的な情報発信をしていきたいというような方向性を個人情報委員会ではいただいております。で、次が今回新しく入ったその個人データを第三者に提供する際に、適切に受け渡しをいただくことを確保するための確認、または記録の義務でございます。こちらについては少しお時間の関係でスキップをさせていただく部分をお許しいただきたいと思いますけれども、基本的な考え方としては、この制度を導入した趣旨は、ご本人の同意なく不適正にということだと思いますけれども、不適正に大量に集められた個人情報が名簿のような形でご本人のコントロールを離れて、不正に流通することを抑止するような制度にしたいということでございます。で、このために、例えば個人情報を第三者に提供するときに、 A さんから B さんに渡すときに、 A さんは B さんに渡しましたということを記録をするわけでありますし、 B さんはA さんから確かな適正な形で、個人情報を受け取ったということを確認し記録をする、こういうような考え方でございます。で、他方この義務を、いざ実践しようと思いますと、個人情報はたくさんの主体の中でたくさんのやり取りがなされております。あえて言えば、真面目に事業を活動している方が個人情報をやり取りしているのにもかかわらず、とんでもないなんか負担のかかるような対応を強いるのは、この法律のこの条文の目的ではないということでございます。そんなこともありまして、事例いくつか書いてございますけれども、それがあればまた後ほどお示ししていきたいと思いますが、例えば事例丸5のようなものであります。一般的にこれ電力会社である人も必ずしもないんですけれども、ある会社が、この利用者山本さんからの申し込みによりまして、振替口座をして、持っている銀行さん、ここに振替をお願いしますよと、振り込みをお願いしますと、これはお給料にせよ公共料金にも支払いにせよ、まあまあある世界だと思いますけれども、これをいちいち全ての1億2000万かよく分かりません、4000万世帯についてこれが必要かというと、必ずしもそうじゃないんじゃないか、 元の契約でその3社間の関係性がきちんと確認できるものについてはこの確認記録義務が適正に満たされているものとして運用を考えるべきではないかこういうような趣旨で、この原則をはご示ししております、まあ、一言で言いますと常識的に考えていきたいと思いますとこういうことでありましてこういうフローズもお示ししておりますけれどもあらゆる常識的な対応をした上で最後に残る先ほど申し上げました問題のある名簿流通のようなケースについては厳格にこれを適用していこうとこういうような考え方でございますで、最後にグローバル化の関係の話でございますこちらにつきましては、外国にある第三者への個人データへの提供これについてはこの一番上のパラグラフの1、2、3のいずれかに該当する場合にこの外国の第三者への提供は可能というふうに改正法で位置づけられたものでございますでこのうちすいませんこのうちこの3の外国にある第三者の個人情報を法人が認めた国に所在する場合というものにつきましてはこれ前回もちょっとご議論の中で私お答え申し上げましたけれども委員会における議論におきましても現在EU、まあ、EU はちょっと今本日ただいまのベッドの話で大変なことになっていますけれどもEU におきましては個人情報保護制度が大きくまた変革期になっておりまたアメリカとの関係で先ほどジムさんのお話も入りましたプライバシーシールドもその制度構築途中というようなことで制度が大きく動いている時期でございますのでこれらについては引き続き検討していこうというような方向性になっておりますこの3の国については当面、直ちにこのどこかの国を指定するというような状況方向性ではないということを、まずは申し上げておきたいと思いますで、それを踏まえて、まあ、ご本人の同意があれば第三国に移転できるという1については当然でありますので、前のページの2の部分どのような場合に、個人情報を外国に、ある第三者に展開できるのかとこれは、個人情報保護法で日本国内でこう担保していただいているような個人情報の適正な取り扱いこれが当該外国においてもきちんと担保されるということを、確認していただくというような形で、担保していただくという形で、お願いしたいということでございます。で、1で書いてございますけれども、提供元と提供先間の契約においてこれがしっかり担保されているというような形での措置を講じていただくことということを委員会としては求めていく方向ではないでしょうかということを書いてございます。で、これらの、契約等々につきましてはもう現在しっかり適切にこの個人情報を外国の方に移転していただいているような事業者さんにおいてはもうすでに講じておられる措置だと理解をしておりますけれどもそのような契約内容について一つ一つ個人情報委員会に届け出をいただく必要はありませんので、適切に当事者間においてそのような体制を確保していただく措置を講じていただくということでご理解いただきたいと思いますで、それ以外の部分につきましては、ガイドライン等々も含めて、定めていくわけでありますけれども、少しお時間を超過しておりますが1点だけ申し上げておきたいと思います今回すみません1人で恐縮なんですが一番目に書いてございますように従来現行個人情報保護法でありました、保有する個人データが5000件以下の事業者さんに対する適用除外の制度この適用除外の制度を撤廃いたします、一件でも個人データをお持ちの事業者さんは適切にこの規律に服していただくということが必要になるわけなんですが、今回新たにこの個人情報保護法の適用と対象となる事業者さんに対しても、適切に改正個人情報保護法の規律に服していただくために 安全管理措置につきましてガイドラインでしっかりお示ししていくというのが政府としての方針でございます。この内容につきましては安全管理措置を、現在講じていただいているような組織的、人的、物理的、技術的といった観点ごとにお示しをしていく部分、これについて、事業者さんに分かりやすくお伝えしていく。で、取り扱う個人データの数が少ない方に向けてもリーズナブルにちゃんとこれを守っていただけるようなものにしていきたいというようなことを書いてございます。でその中身につきましては現行もうすでに実施しております個人番号法、マイナンバー法の安全管理措置、これはあらゆる事業者さんが事業規模問わずこう対応していただいておりますので、それと基本的に同じ内容を求めていこうというようなことをガイドラインでお示ししておくということでございます。ガイドラインでは示していこうというような方向性であります。でその次のページも同様のことが書いてございまして、その、求めていく内容について、例えば特にやはりハンドリングする個人情報の数が少ない、個人データの数が少ない方の目安に対しては、例えば個人情報保護法ガイドラインにおいても、マイナンバー法のガイドラインと同様に、従業員の数が100人以下の事業者さんについては、そのような措置を講じていくというようなことを考えたらいいのではないか。これはもうマイナンバー法で実際行っているわけなんですけれども、そのような考え方を示しています。なので個人情報法の新たに規律対象となっていただく方は、基本的にマイナンバー法の対応をしっかりやっていただければ大丈夫というような道筋というふうにしていきたいなというような考え方でございます。ということで、最近マイナちゃんもにっこり笑うキャラもできましたので、またご愛顧いただきたいと思いますけれども、雑把でございますが私からのご説明とさせていただきたいと思います。ご清聴ありがとうございました。
Thank you very much, Councillor Yamamoto. Very interesting presentation. Professor Park is going to be next up. Professor Park and I have worked together almost 5 years now, working on cybersecurity and privacy matters. And I was in Seoul in May for a conference on privacy, on cybersecurity, and we were talking about the two systems, this system in Korea and the system that is now being developed in Japan with respect to cloud computing. Koreans just passed a law on cloud computing in 2015. Japan is not developing a legislative framework, they're developing guidelines. But I remarked to Professor Park in the context of that seminar that I thought the Japanese government was really moving in the right way in this area, because they were providing the opportunity for a lot of flexibility and for a lot of growth and interpretation of the law. And I must say, I'm very encouraged with Councillor Yamamoto's description of what they've been doing over the last few months. I think it's absolutely in the right direction. It understands that this is a very serious, important matter. You don't have trust in terms of sharing data, sharing economy doesn't work. On the other hand, if you don't have flexibility, it doesn't work either. And I think that this is a very thoughtful approach. So I'm delighted now that Professor Park has joined us. This time he's going to talk, we talked about cybersecurity last month. He's going to try to offer us an assessment of where Korea is with their thinking and with their guidelines on privacy. But also in this context, I think it was very, very important, because it's hard to get information in Korea about how Japan is developing its framework. So this, I think, was a very good opportunity for him to see and hear directly from senior Japanese government officials as to where things are going. So, Professor Park, please.
Thank you, Professor Foster. Regarding the cloud computing adopted last year, I talk if I have time later, but now, initially I was asked to speak about the recent developments in Korean data privacy laws. First, we have the constitution, but the constitution does not explicitly provide for data privacy as a basic law, but about 10 years ago, we have the constitutional court different from the Supreme Court, and the constitutional court recognized the right to data privacy as a basic law. And we have in the bottom the Personal Information Protection Act, we simply call the PIPA, as a basic law. It was adopted in 2011. But before that enactment, there were a lot of data privacy laws in specific areas. For example, in the blue circle box, there are two laws. One is, we call it simply Network Act, and another one is Location Information Act. And these two acts are rather, I think, more active and more influential in reality, although we have a basic act. And also in the second column, there is the law governing so-called financial and credit information. As I said, the Personal Information Protection Act was adopted in 2011, but the purpose was amended in 3 years. It's ridiculous to see the amendment of the purpose. But even the revised purpose has a problem. I think that is the unbalance. I mean, the PIPA, its purpose is only to protect information, personal information, or data protection. It does not care about the use of personal information. Although PIPA as a law on data protection, its main provisions should be about data protection, but I think like GDPR or any other laws or the treaties, I think at least the purpose should mention the other part, use of personal information. So now Korean government is in difficulty in reconciling those strict and rigid data protection law with digital economy, including big data. So although last year, as I said, the Cloud Computing Act was adopted, the act still defers there is a provision on the data protection in the Cloud Computing Act, and that provision says those matters regarding data protection in the cloud computing services still governed by those data privacy laws. So that is our big problem for the development of big data and digital economy. And this year, 2016, 2015, 2014, Korean data privacy laws have experienced a big amendment. One of the reasons is the disclosure of the massive leakage of personal information involving around 100 million people from the three credit card companies. So Korean population is 50 million, then the number of the leakage was 100 million. So after that incident, the Korean government, and also I think our president, I mean, has been having more interest in, personal interest in this area. So I briefly explain about some developments. First, the resident registration numbers is similar to my number in Japan. I think we introduced this system in 1970s only for the national security purposes. At the time, we had to tell the real Korean nationals from the others, including the North Korean attackers. So we introduced this system as a national security purpose. But since then, it was very easy for even commercial companies to use this number for, I mean, recognizing their own customers. So very recently, Korean government has been tightening the control over the collection and use of the resident registered numbers. So first, all those numbers must be encrypted, but differentially, depending on the number of the resident registration numbers. For example, data handlers are similar to data controllers in the European Union. Data handlers holding less than 1 million resident registration numbers must complete the encryption by January the 1st, 2017. And data handlers holding over 1 million resident registration numbers must complete the encryption by January 1st, 2018. And also, the PIPAP has introduced the two specific damages. One statutory damages, another is punitive damages. So, although basically the victims may ask compensation from those data handlers, normally Korean courts used to provide around $100, not more than $200 per person. But now, for the statutory damages, those victims may ask up to approximately $3,000. And also, the court may award up to three times the amount of actual loss. So now, I mean, those companies in Korea, the data handlers, are very much likely to pay more, a lot. And also, with the introduction of those specific damages, the sanctions, the punishment level have been increased quite in a significant way. And also, the Personal Information Protection Commission. The commission is rather, unstable status. It is not a kind of data protection authority as found in the European Union. Because we have at least three big important laws like the PIPA and Network Act and Credit Information Act. The Credit Information Act is governed or whole held by the Financial Services Commission, and the Network Act is held and operated or regularly governed by the Korean Communications Commission, and the PIPA is governed by the Ministry of the Interior. So, when we see Personal Information Protection Commission, that commission should be expected to allow to have right authority for the data protection in Korea, but it is not yet. So in the past 3 years, this commission has been given more authority and power. So for example, the Ministry of the Interior has given the power on the establishment of basic plans for protection of personal information to the commission, and also the mediation of disputes involving personal information. That function is also given to the commission from the Ministry of the Interior. And also, most importantly, the commission is now able to give the idea of the infringement of the data protection to government agencies which are intending to enact or amend statutes and regulations. So now the commission is in a right track on the data protection policy making and also implementation. And the security measures for sensitive information has been strengthened. For example, sensitive information should be protected through the encryption. And again, the resident registration numbers. Now, data subject cannot be asked to give his or her consent for the collection of their own resident registration numbers. Those numbers may be only collected under the legal basis, law and regulations. And now those regulations are specified into seven things, presidential decree and other regulations. So in this way, there is a limited scope of the collection of the registration numbers. Now, I'll be finishing my presentation by this kind of conclusion. So I think at least there are three challenges for the data privacy laws in Korea. First, as I mentioned in the beginning, those data privacy laws should not prevent the development of the digital economy, including big data. But as I said, although we have the Cloud Computing Act to promote cloud computing services, but the Act still is dependent on the data privacy laws, which are very strict and rigid against the development of cloud computing services. But fortunately, in May this year, our president, the was given a report from the ministries about the easiness, deregulating data protection for the cloud computing services development. And second, the PIPA and its commission must be placed as a basic, real basic law and institution for data protection. And for me, I'm teaching data protection law at my school, but I mean, each year I'm teaching, but I feel dizzy every time I teach because I have to look at any change from the PIPA. I mainly teach the PIPA, but actually, as I said, the Network Act and Credit Information Act and Location Information Act and the other laws are very much more important than the PIPA in any sense. So I think those provisions in those specific area laws should be integrated into the PIPA. And those specific laws should deal with those specific aspects of data protection. And finally, data privacy laws in Korea must be open to and accommodate the international development, I mean, covering the cross-border transfer of personal data. And for this purpose, I understand the Ministry of the Interior is now negotiating with the European Commission for the adequacy decision. So for this purpose, next month there will be a seminar between the European Commission and the Ministry of Interior this kind of subject. So we have been experiencing many amendments, but in reality, the hatching. So, but anyway, I hope by learning from European Union and Japan, now Korean legal system for data protection should improve in the right direction. Thank you very much.
As I said, Professor Park and I have been working together for almost 5 years now, and I don't think very often you hear such a frank and interesting assessment of what is happening in Korea with their data protection laws, the challenges that they're having at trying to introduce big data, cloud computing, and of course you have to understand as well, you've got the security backdrop there. Very, very profound and difficult national security questions that also impact upon not only privacy, but also cybersecurity. So I think it offers a very, very interesting counterpoint. Japan and Korea are only, what, 90 minutes away from each other by plane. And yet, and indeed are the leading countries with respect to all the innovation that's going on in these new data sharing areas. And yet you can see that the legal systems there are in many ways very, very different. So I think it's very useful to have these kinds of conversations and to see how each country is trying to work with these issues. And that's why, too, delighted to have our good friend Mike Panzera. This is the second time we've welcomed him to Keio. And this time, personal information, promotion of big data, all those things are very, very important in the context of the United States. But one of the really hot issues now is what do we do with the Internet of Things? And I know that Mr. Yamamoto and his staff are trying to think through that. And so actually the Federal Trade Commission has recently come up with some thinking on that, a staff report, and Mike is going to talk about that. I also asked if we have specific questions, particularly from the panel, that he be prepared to talk about the privacy shield, and I don't know whether the EU exists anymore or not, but I think, Mike, you heard, both in the case of the presentation from Councillor Yamamoto and with Professor Park, both countries
are profoundly influenced by the question of what kind of adequacy or what kind of relationship they can have with the EU. And so in that particular context, how the US negotiated its arrangements is obviously of keen interest. So thank you, Mike.
I agree that it's always an interesting discussion to talk about the different approaches and different legal frameworks and how they address the issue and try and reach the same result, but using their own unique economic realities and legal frameworks, but try and get to the same position. Before I begin my speech, I should indicate, my boss requires me to say that the views that I express in this speech are my own and do not necessarily reflect those of the commissioner or the commissioner. And I always say that, and at first I felt like kind of an insult. I was like, of course my views are consistent with what, you know, the FTC would say. But then afterwards I realized it's like a liberation, because now I can say whatever I want. You know, as long as I have that little disclaimer there, you know, I can say whatever views I want to say. But the reason why I chose Internet of Things as a topic of discussion, although it's interesting in its own right, I think it's a good example of how the FTC approaches emerging practices and technologies using its existing authority. Because I think even though it's a little hard to understand from the outside how the, you know, it works in a common law system, it does allow us a certain amount of flexibility in applying our general authority in certain contexts as technologies and practices evolve. So that's why I chose Internet of Things to use as an example of how that works. So obviously we have primary general jurisdiction in consumer protection. And one of our top priorities is protecting privacy and security of consumer data. So as you may know, our statute is very broadly written. It indicates that we have jurisdiction to prohibit unfair or deceptive practices in commerce. So that could entail a whole range of activities in commerce, and we interpret that to mean that it includes certain obligations of companies to protect privacy and data security of consumers in a commercial setting. That has been challenged. You may be aware of the Wyndham case, the defendant asserted that the Federal Trade Commission did not have jurisdiction, and we prevailed in court, and that's been upheld on appeal, so we will continue to fight that to the Supreme Court if necessary. But it's always amusing when sometimes I speak with our counterparts, for example, in the European Union. I had a German researcher come to my office one day and said, "You don't have any privacy laws, it's like the Wild West." You know, and I was like, "Oh, take out my guns." And I was like, "That's news to me. I mean, we've brought over 500 cases, you know, in federal court involving privacy and data security." And so even though our legal regime is different, you know, we're applying our general authority in the context of privacy and data security, and we elaborate the rules through litigation, through consent orders, by providing guidance to consumers and to businesses through education materials, reports, staff reports, I should say. We also convene workshops where we invite members from the private sector, consumer and privacy advocacy groups. We recognize technology experts. We recognize that we can't be an expert in every single technology that emerges. So we rely on these types of mechanisms to gather.
Mike, could you speak just a bit slower, because our interpreters are trying to keep up with the brilliance of your thought.
Okay. Sorry, it's just I only have 15 minutes in this.
Take your time.
Okay. And so when we issue a staff report or a guideline, it provides a signal to the business community about how we are interpreting the Federal Trade Commission Act, our General Jurisdiction Act, in the context at issue. For example, in this case, the Internet of Things. We recently issued a comment, a staff comment, in response to the Department of Commerce, National Telecommunications and Information Administration, NTIA, we issued a staff comment to them explaining what our interpretation is regarding these obligations in the context of the Internet of Things, and we also specified some best practice recommendations. So today I'd like to explain a little bit about what those benefits and risks are, and also what the recommendations are, understanding obviously that even though this is our interpretation, it could form the basis of an enforcement action later, because courts will generally defer to our interpretation of these principles. So obviously, we're all aware of the revolutionary effects of the Internet of Things. We're seeing consumers adopting IoT devices that are opening up benefits in many sectors, healthcare, energy efficiency, transportation. What we're also seeing now is kind of a second stage, where we're combining big data and the Internet of Things to create even more benefits, the synergy of both of these mechanisms. For example, big data analysis of information collected from connected health devices, facilitating health research and leading to breakthroughs in treatment. Similarly, analysis of data collected from connected public infrastructure to detect lighting patterns on public streets, can improve energy efficiency. So we're seeing a convergence of all of these trends, which obviously will provide great benefits to people. But obviously, without every great benefit, there are potential risks. And that is in terms of the ways in which data is generated, collected, and transmitted by these tools can present potential security and privacy risks that may expose consumers to the possibility of identity theft, fraud, and also the association and aggregation of sensitive personal information that a consumer would prefer to keep private. So it's a loss of control, in other words. First I'll talk about security and then privacy in terms of risks. So even though there have been security risks that have been present with respect to traditional computers and computer networks, these security risks are heightened in the IoT sphere, in part because IoT chips are inexpensive, disposable, and many devices are quickly replaceable with newer versions. And so as a result, businesses may not have an incentive to support software updates for the full useful life of the device. So that leaves consumers potentially with vulnerable devices, and that it may be difficult or impossible to apply updates to certain devices. So even though at the beginning of the life cycle there may be adequate security, as the life cycle evolves of that device, it may not necessarily be the case. Beyond security risks, there are also concerns regarding consumer privacy that have been detected in this recent staff comment. And that involves specifically the direct collection of sensitive personal information, such as precise geolocation, financial account information, health information. In one analysis, the FTC staff found the presence of numerous third parties in apps that were connected to IoT health and fitness wearable devices. So a number of those third parties were collecting data such as persistent device identifiers, workout routines, eating habits, length of walking stride, medical search history, zip code, gender, geolocation, everything. What they were doing with this information, who knows? But they were collecting this information, and then many times the consumers weren't even aware of that. So these devices are capable of collecting, transmitting, sharing highly sensitive information about consumers' bodies and habits. And these implications may increase if consumers' health routines, dietary habits, etc., are combined with offline sources and across devices. So the potential for harm is multiplying with every connection. So specifically regarding the best practices that the FTC is recommending, first with respect to security, it's broadly recognized that negative privacy and security experiences can have a direct impact on consumer trust. So that could lead to adverse consequences for IoT innovation and acceptance. So the FTC maintains that it's in the interest of these companies that are innovating to ensure that there are secure measures throughout the life cycle of the device. So all we're saying is that at a minimum there should be reasonable security measures, and we pointed to five common sense steps that businesses that are creating security programs in the IoT space should incorporate into their device. First, the company should be building security into their devices at the outset, very standard privacy by design, but in this case, security by design. Second, they should train employees on good security practices, and there are a number of types of advice that the FTC has included in there. Third, these companies should ensure downstream privacy and data protections through vendor contracts and oversight. Fourth, these companies should apply what's called defense in depth strategies that offer protections at multiple levels and interfaces. So it's basically a built-in redundancy of security so that if one system fails, there's a backup in place. Finally, these companies should have in place reasonable access controls. So in our comment, the FTC staff also stressed the importance of patching and frequent software updates to reduce hacking opportunities and data minimization to reduce the risk of privacy violations. So many consumers purchase the IoT devices with the expectation that privacy and security will be protected throughout the life of the product. So the question here is, when is that possible? So we understand that there are limitations, but those limitations need to be made clear to the consumers up front, and such that we recommend, in a sense, expiration dates for IoT devices so that consumers better understand that the security that's offered at the outset is not necessarily going to maintain throughout the life cycle of the product. Turning to privacy, the FTC staff also discussed best practices for privacy protection apart from security that encourage companies to minimize data protection and develop policies and practices that impose reasonable limits on the collection and retention of consumer data. So we addressed specifically the concept of consumer choice in this context, recognizing the ubiquity of data collection and the practical obstacles to providing information to consumers when the product lacks a consumer interface. So we nevertheless concluded that offering consumers notice and choice in the IoT context is still important and practicable, and suggested that when users are that such choice be available in a way that's consistent with consumers' expectations. I'll give you a brief example. So suppose Mrs. Yamamoto in Yokohama buys a smart rice cooker from Nihon Home Appliances Manufacturing Company. And that smart rice cooker is connected to an app that allows the consumer to remotely turn the rice cooker on to a particular setting at a particular time. So before Mrs. Yamamoto is leaving the office at the end of the day, she wants to have rice already cooked by the time she gets home. She can use this app to set that in motion. Great. So now, turning to what the consumer expectation is, if this company decides to use the consumer's appliance usage information to improve the sensitivity of its temperature sensors or to recommend another product to the consumer, it need not offer the consumer an express choice for those uses, because those uses are consistent with its existing relationship with the consumer. On the other hand, if the manufacturer shares consumers' personal data with a data broker or an ad network, such sharing would be inconsistent with the context of the consumer's relationship with the manufacturer because it's outside of what the normal expectations would be. So that in that case, the company should give the consumer a choice at the outset. In conclusion, protecting, essentially what's driving our analysis is consumer expectations. So Protecting privacy and security and assuring fairness is very complex, especially when technologies are rapidly changing. But basic consumer protection principles can provide a compass to guide us through this complexity. So consumers want and expect reasonable assurances that companies are keeping the data collected and as well as connected devices in a secure manner. Consumers want to know what data companies are collecting about them, how companies are using it, and how they can exercise some control over the collection and use of that data. And consumers want to know that they are not being treated unfairly or in a discriminatory manner. So the rapid changes in big data analytics and the Internet of Things, as well as cross-border flows of data, yes, they have made it difficult to meet some of these expectations and have made it difficult for enforcers in applying our general authority in specific contexts, but that doesn't mean it's necessarily impossible. The key point is that these enduring expectations of consumers need to be met in some way. Meeting these expectations and ensuring consumer trust so that these practices and technologies can develop and innovation is not inhibited is key to realizing the full potential of this highly connected, data-driven world. So all of us, government officials, representatives of industry, civil society leaders, we all have important roles to play in determining how best to strike that balance between encouraging innovation while ensuring effective mechanisms for consumer privacy and data security. Applying these well-established principles in new contexts, yes, it is a challenge, but with closer international cooperation and enhanced interoperability among privacy regimes, I have no doubt that we will all rise to that challenge. So, thank you very much.
You know, I was just struck in listening to the three presentations that, and I may be wrong, and I'd like to get some comments, particularly from our panel here, that the three governments are kind of trying to do the same thing, but in different ways. I mean, for example, you heard Councillor Yamamoto describe the different sort of guidelines, the way the government is working with these areas. And one of the most impressive things about the revision of Japan's privacy framework was the insertion of language saying that the purpose of the act was to promote the utilization of data. And you almost hear it at every step. Councillor Yamamoto is trying to protect data, but he also wants to promote the use of data. So trying to be very flexible. Very, very interesting. Professor Pak, you know, is actually pointed out very strongly that in Korea, one of the real obstacles is the fact that protecting data has become very much the key principle for the law. There's a recognition that they want to promote the use of data in different kinds of cases, but the way the law is written and the requirements and actually their experience with massive data losses, there's a huge emphasis upon not just protection, but also, as you heard, enforcement of the law. I mean, very significant financial penalties for breaches. $3,000 may not sound like a lot of money, but if you lose a million pieces of data, that becomes a huge, huge sum for a company. And then I was listening to Mike, and it's kind of interesting because he's not talking about data, or he's talking about people and consumers. And in some respects, the two approaches are quite integrated because consumers, of course, want their data protected, but at the same minute, they want to get the benefits from having their data used. And so Mike and his team are trying to think through how to do that, particularly in a case where you're not protecting driver's licenses or resident registration cards, but you're protecting data that's gathered by this watch. and it's being used in some very interesting sorts of ways. So I think it's very interesting to see how these different perspectives are actually producing different types, not necessarily different types of guidelines, but different ways of managing property or privacy. So we have a really interesting group of people assembled tonight for the multi-stakeholder panel. I'm not going to introduce them individually. You can read your programs. In fact, I hope that most of the people in the room know these people. They've been working very, very hard in a large variety of ways on this. And so, initially, I'm just going to throw out a question to the panel, and I'd like the panel maybe to react to it, but then as well begin to raise some questions or make some statements that will encourage a response from our panelists. And it really comes down to this question of what exactly are we protecting? Are we protecting personal information as defined by different sorts of driver's licenses or human personal characteristics? I was very interested in the large enumeration of these things. And I'm not sure that that's the same situation in Korea, and I'm definitely sure it's not the same situation in the United States. And so I'm kind of a little bit puzzled by that. Does somebody have a view on that? I'd like to get a comment from the panel first. Obata-san?
Yeah. I think considering my family or the people I talk to, the trend among the consumers is they're trying to protect not really like the personal information or personal identity, they're trying to protect the record, the personal record of everything. So let's say. So nowadays, like the nursery schools or kindergarten or whatever, so especially private ones, they start to disclose what they're doing. And even to the public, because they're trying to say we have a safe kindergarten, we have safe nursery. But of course, to do that, they have to disclose all the pictures or whatever, where the children are playing, or what the staffs are doing, which are really private information. And of course, there's no name on it. It doesn't say who this kid is. But they are already allowing the kids or the parents to opt out all the pictures if they don't like it. So I think there are many cases like this, you don't want your just private record to be disclosed anywhere or kept anywhere. And I'm a little, I'm concerned what happens if that you give out the information with no personal identity. Let's say that you subscribe to a device or you get a device or whatever. You don't just get all the records by yourself, but you don't add any of your private, your identity at all. But that someday, somebody picks up one data and says, oh, the Bluetooth information, all these things belong to that guy before. And then he can trace everything that you thought that it was not. It didn't have a private identity. So these things are, I think, very sensitive to the consumers now. That's becoming a new trend, especially for the kids.
Yamamoto-san, do you have some comments from Facebook's perspective on this? You guys collect a lot of information.
Yeah, and Facebook is protecting every personal information, and the users have a full control of their personal data, so don't worry about it. Sorry. I have two questions for one for SCCR Mark and one for Yamamoto-san. And you said kind of consumer trust is the most important thing to balancing encouraging innovation or the consumer security. Find out that some of the balance point is the most important things. And we in Japan we try to do the same thing, but then if we meet with the privacy very very vocal people about the privacy, or maybe privacy academia and the industry, never end this story. they're discussing every, you know, many, many years, but we can't reach to get to the, you know, kind of a trust or maybe, you know, a mutual understanding point. It's very difficult. How did the U.S. government achieve that kind of, you know, harmonization between our, the consumer sector and the industry sector? And for Mr. Yamamoto-san, I just discussed with some of the colleagues of the Japanese industry, and you know, taking example for the face recognition, you know, if the company would like to take their picture and just investigate the men or women or you know, around what age is, you know, just taking that kind of the purpose, no want to have, you know, in, no interested in taking the picture and stored in anything. But the current law, you know, prohibits to do that. You need to have a kind of consensus with the each individuals. So the most of the company in Japan is doing their R&D in the U.S. instead of in Japan. So things is happening already here. So how do you going to manage this situation? How do you, you know, balancing the innovation and the privacy protection?
Mike, you wanna?
Sure. Is this working? Is it going?
Yeah.
Every time the topic of trust comes up in the context, oh, sorry, it wasn't. Every time trust comes up in the topic in the context of privacy discussions, you know, the question arises: how do you ensure that? And I remember sitting on a plane last year, and we started talking about privacy. I started talking about privacy with the guy next to me from Honduras. I was telling him that I was on my way down to Peru to give a conference on e-commerce and things like that. And he said, oh, in my entire life, I've only purchased one thing online from an e-commerce platform. It was like an airplane or something. I can't even imagine in 2016, like, only once in your life actually purchasing something online. And the reason is there's a lack of trust because they don't know what's going to happen to their information or their account number, or, you know, once it goes out into the void. And fundamental there is they have the perception in certain areas that there will be no consequence for a company that violates any of the protections. So there has to be some mechanism for enforcement. It's really great to have a set of laws on paper with lots of great principles enshrined in, you know, in words, but unless there's muscle, some way to punish the bad actors, then there isn't going to be that kind of trust. And this benefit redounds to the businesses as well, because all e-commerce operators will benefit from greater trust in general when we punish those bad actors, right? So even though it may be, in the short term, it could be burdensome for legitimate companies, you know, take that extra step to make sure that there are proper security measures and a plan in place in case there's a breach, and et cetera, et cetera. In the end, if they're all doing this in a way, then it kind of converges into a general feeling that this sector is something that they've been engaged in. The response to your question, though, was earlier, was about expectations. You know, are we protecting data or are we protecting people? And I have the very firm sense that we're protecting people. And the way, we're not doing it in a paternalistic way, like you can't do it, because it all comes down to choice, informed consumer choice. Our sense is that if consumers are made aware of what's happening with their data, they can decide whether or not to engage in a transaction with that particular company. The problem is like now there are, you know, these huge privacy policies that nobody reads. So we had to shift our attention to how that information is presented
And what's key here is consumer expectations. So the one side of the coin, obviously, as I was talking about, is evolving business practices, evolving technology. We all like to talk about that. But less sexy is evolving consumer expectations, right? Because consumers, maybe 10 years ago, had no idea what, you know, if they were downloading an app, you know, what was happening to their personal data, was it harvesting their contact information, you know, and but over time, awareness was growing as there were more media reports and more enforcement action by the FTC, among other things. Consumers became more aware of what was happening. And so there have been studies done about consumer expectations. And so if you ask, you know, an average consumer in the United States, you know, how do you feel about privacy and protection of your personal information? Oh, it's very important. Like 99% of people will say, this is extremely important to me. I'm very upset. If, you know, what if a company gave you, you know, a $5 coupon in exchange for your social security numbers? You know, that number goes way down. Oh, sure, have it. You know, $5, that's great. So, I mean, there's a segment, though, of the population that understands that there's value to personal information and that there's a trade-off. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they're aware of all of the risks. So the government does have a role in ensuring that there's protection there, even when they engage in these types of transactions and provide their information. So it's a balance, and we have, and it's country specific in many cases, because what consumers' expectations are in one country may not necessarily be the same in another country. So you can't just take one regime and plop it down in another country. It won't work. It really is guided by what consumers expect and demand in terms of practices, but also what the government responses in terms of consequences. So very long answer, but I hopefully that answered your question. Sorry.
これから述べる見解は申し訳ないと言いたいまして、PPCの公式な見解でございます。まず、私は今のマイクさんのコメントに賛成でありまして、個人情報保護法我が国の個人情報保護法も目的としておりますのは、個人情報の有用性に配慮しながら、個人の権利利益を保護するというものになっております。 なので、様々な個人の皆さんのその感じ方、多様な、こういったことを踏まえた対応というのがやはり必要だということは、多分、センスとして共有できるものかなと思いました。で、その上で、ご質問の、例えば顔のデータについての、利用活用のお話であります。 ここも、我が国においては、これまで防犯カメラのような形での、個人の、顔に関するその、データ利用というのがなされてきたということになっていると思います。で、我が国ではカメラが設置されているとそこでやはり個人に関する振る舞いも含めた情報、行動履歴が 集められているというふうに、そこに訪れた人々がやはり感じるわけでありまして、我が国でのプラクティスがそこで防犯カメラ作動中ですという掲示をするということで、その個人に関する情報をどのような目的でどのように利用しているかということについて、そこで掲示をしてお伝えするということが、プラクティスとして確立してきていると思います。 で、今ご質問のあった話はそこからさらに進んで、防犯目的ではない形でも、どのような利用ができていくのかということに関連するのではないかと思います。で、私自身はそのような観点での利活用はどんどんまた進めるべきだと思います。例えば、防犯以外に様々な場面で、 安全を、交通の局面なのか、またはたまた、
鉄道のプラットフォームから転落、まあ、プラットフォーム上に例えばたくさんの人がいれば困るわけでありますし、その人数を把握するためにそういうような、カメラであったりなんかデータというのは有用だというのを話し、などは私も知識として承知しています。そういうようなデータの集め方、使われ方みたいなものを適切に人々に理解いただけるような形での取り扱い、これは我が国においても勧めていくべきではないかなという気がします。で、ここで一つ問題になるのは、そこでカメラで集められているデータが先ほどお話にもあった通り、実はあの非常にぼやけた曖昧なデータでありまして、そこにあのどなたかわかりませんが人がいますと、こういうようなデータを集めている可能性もあります。ありますが、 人々はカメラが、カメラで画像を集めていると、先ほどの防犯カメラなどの中のようなデータが集められている可能性があるというふうにおそらく考えると思います。ここについて、どのような形で、どのようなデータを分かりやすく、簡潔に集めていくかということについての、ある種のパブリックリレーションをどう考えていくのか、それはおそらく個々の企業での プライバシー、プライバシーとしてのご説明かもしれませんし、ある種はそういう、あるいはそういう特定の目的での企業群が、ある種の公益にもかなうものとして取り組むというときに、政府も交えてこう対応していくかもしれないですよね。このあたりはさまざまな可能性があると思います。その意味で、我々としては、 個人情報のきちんと確保されるという観点からの私ども確認をしていく一方で、先ほど事務さんからもご説明ありましたように、個人情報の利活用というのは、政府としても我が PPC としても図っていくということは、これはもう決められている任務ミッションになっておりますので、そういう観点でここに対応していくのかなという気もします。で、その意味で R&D は海外でということだったんですけれども、ぜひ日本でやっていただいたらいいなと思いますが、個人情報保護法の取り扱いでは、学術研究目的での学術研究に携わる人たちが個人情報ハンドリングすることについてはこれは適用除外になるんですね。当然それ方々は自ら自主的に適切なルールのもとで取り扱っていただくことが前提でありますけれども、そういうようなことでも対応するので、さまざまな顔画像の利活用も含めたデータの活用が進むということは、私は賛成ですし、そのような道可能性は大いにあるのではないかというふうに期待します。以上です。
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask Professor Miyashita a question because he wrote a very famous article about 2 or 3 years ago, as I recall, that made the assertion that enforcement is not necessary in Japan because reputation would encourage companies to act appropriately. And of course, I think he's exactly right if you look at the record of enforcement actions under the Personal Information Protection Act before it was revised. Essentially, there was no enforcement. Mike, on the other hand, just made the extremely strong argument that predictable enforcement is the best guarantee of privacy. So I'd like to get your reaction to that. Because we also have a situation here in Korea where enforcement, at least as I understand it, is a little bit out of control. Now, of course, massive data breaches have had a very strong public reaction. The fact is that the penalties in Korea for misuse of data are really very, very severe. And Professor Pott was making the argument that that really has slowed adoption of the cloud, big data, and other technologies by Koreans. And that was a message when we did this conference on cloud computing last month in Korea, and you were there. We you heard very, very strongly. So I'd like to get your comments on that. I mean, are you changing your attitude towards enforcement, or is Japan just an exception?
Yes, thank you very much, first of all, for giving me an opportunity to raise questions. By the way, I just published a new article, Full Silo is a tale of two privacies, not a tale of two cities, like a joke, Dickens. A tale of two privacies, between the hard power and soft power. So, I would like to raise a question, three of you. From US perspectives, I think the hard power, which is namely law enforcement, is essential for the privacy protections. But from the Japanese side, from my experience as a privacy officer in the cabinet office, name and shame does work under the Japanese climate of business. So, what are the views, Mr. Yamamoto? Do you think we should also appeal to the law enforcement, like FTC's experience? Or do we need to introduce Korean punitive damages, which is very interesting for me at least? So, what are the opinions from after seeing the FTC enforcement actions? And Michael, I would like to ask questions to you as well. What's the attitude of the FTC for using the soft power, which is namely like digital education or name and shame appeal in the US business climate? And finally, I'd like to ask Professor Taka about your situation.
Councillor Yamamoto?私から答えしたいと思います。私の実感におきましても、日本においては非常に強い取り締まりを継続的に行っていく必要は必ずしもないというのが現時点における私の印象です。宮下先生がおっしゃっていただいたように、多くの日本企業は 企業としてのコンプライアンスにある種大変真摯に徹底的に取り組んでいただいておりまして、それが故に私ども委員会 PIPC に対してもルールのディテールについてのご質問がたくさんいただくわけなんですけれども、そのような姿勢の中では適切にやはり ルールをお示ししこれにおご理解いただくことで、私としては日本においては個人情報の取り扱いを事業者さんが適切に行っていただけるということについては確保できるのではないかと思います。ただし最近の事案について個人情報の防衛事案などを見ると、どちらかというとその 適切にこれを取り扱おうとしておられる企業に対する不正なアクセスによる流出みたいなことがやはり大きくなっております。で、こういったことはどなたを追及すべきか、誰を、パニッシュすべきかということで言えば、それは不正なアクセスを仕掛けるアイテムだと思っておりまして、日本政府としてはそのようなサイバーセキュリティに対して、しっかり対応していこうと。 いうようなことが公的部門もちろん民間部門の皆さんに対しても政府としての方針だということは最後に申し上げたいと思います。とりあえずよろしくお願いします。Professor
Park, do you want to comment?
Yes, thank you, Professor Yamashita. I mean, you mentioned hard power and soft power. Or hard enforcement or soft enforcement. I think in Korea, I mean, in the KIPAM, there is a provision on the data breach notifications and data handlers who violated the law and rejecting the data subsidies have been victims of that violation, then those data subsidies should be notified for those data handlers. And data handlers also should be notified to the authorities. So I think that is kind of the soft power, I mean, in your terms, kind of naming, shaming. And also, these days in Korea, newspapers are very fond of reporting those data breaches. So in that sense, I think Korean companies are now very much sensitive about how to deal with their customers' personal information. But later, may I ask a question?
Sure.
Now?
Yes.
Yeah.
But, well, let's have Mike respond and then we can go to the question.
Well, just clarifying something regarding data breach in the United States. So, as you may be aware, there are, I think, 48 states now that have data breach law, data breach notification laws, with varying requirements and degrees of specificity. I believe most companies follow California's law or Massachusetts because it's the highest standard. And even though there isn't a federal data breach notification law, we, under the Federal Trade Commission Act, have brought numerous cases in the context of data breaches. But the fundamental principle here is not that if there's a data breach, there's a violation. It's quite the opposite. Actually, the way it works is the fundamental principle is we operate from the premise that there's no such thing as 100% security. It's impossible. With evolving technologies, with the amount of risks and malware and hackers coming from all different directions, we recognize that it's impossible to have a system that's not, you know, that's 100% perfect and not vulnerable to attack. So proceeding from that premise, simply because there's a breach does not necessarily mean that there's a violation of the law or that their systems were unreasonably insecure. Conversely, simply because there was not a breach and that consumers' information was not accessed and people weren't injured does not necessarily mean that their system was reasonable. So we can bring an action against a company for violating the FTC Act for an unreasonable data security system even though there was no breach, even though there was no consumer injury. I mean, usually there's a breach, but not necessarily. The theoretical underpinning is an important point because we recognize that there's a limitation to what the companies can do. The second principle is that we take into consideration many factors, including the company's position, ability to prevent some type of data breach. Smaller companies are maybe, they don't have the resources to buy the latest updates and whatever. Bigger companies are in a better position to do that. So there are many factors that we take into consideration. And I don't know whether it would be necessarily better to have a regime where every breach resulted in a fine, because we recognize that in some circumstances it wouldn't be appropriate. The other point that I'd like to make is that, yes, hackers, you know, people who are accessing data without authorization should be punished under civil or criminal law. It's not mutually exclusive, though, to say that the companies don't have some responsibility. I mean, the companies also have some obligations under the law. We recognize that it's unfortunate in some circumstances that there was a breach, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're off the hook. So, with respect to your question about soft power, I think the soft power informs everything that we do. We bring enforcement actions all the time. We view ourselves more as an enforcement authority rather than a regulatory authority. We do have regulations, but we're more enforcement. But the enforcement actions mostly result in settlements. And the settlements result in consent orders that bind the the companies to take certain actions, to refrain from certain actions, and that gives us a hook to make sure that, that they're complying going forward, first of all, to that individual company. But it also sends a message to other companies in that particular sector that are using a particular practice that they also should look at what happened to this company, and to avoid what's happening to that company, they should take certain steps. Those consent orders are very detailed, and they give a lot of guidance to companies about what best practices are to avoid a similar situation. But also, we also recognize that the vast majority of legitimate companies want to do the right thing, and that we also have an obligation to educate these companies so that they know what the best practices are, what our interpretation is, to avoid an enforcement action. We're a small agency. We can't sue every time there's a violation. We have to really target, you know, certain practices that are problematic, because we're mindful that it sends a message to other companies. So that even though hard power is seen as an enforcement action, everything we do is informed by that soft power approach. We want to make sure that people are understanding what those best practices are. Even if they're not necessarily having to pay a money judgment, there are obligations and requirements that send a message to other companies.
Professor Park, you had a question?
Yes. My understanding is why Japan has very quickly amended the Personal Information Protection Act is to, the economic growth under the Abenomics. Then I'd like to ask probably Councillor Yamamoto, what is the legal basis which could be used for big data purposes in the new amendment, and also in the GDPR in the EU, there are the concepts of pseudonymization and anonymization. And my understanding is that, in the GDPR, the pseudonymization is defined, but anonymization is not actually in the main text, but in the recital. But anyway, I think pseudonymization in the GDPR might be used for big data. But then, as Councillor Yamamoto explained in his presentation, de-identification. So de-identification is equivalent to the pseudonymization of the GDPR. Of the EU or anonymization of the EU, and if the latter is the case, then anonymization as the de-identification may be rather strict, may be difficult for big data in reality.
まず私の方から、この今回の改正にあたって、ビッグデータの活用というのが、どのように意識されているかということについてご説明をしたいと思います。今回の個人情報保護の改正の一つの大きなテーマというのが、パーソナルデータの利活用をもっと進めようと いう問題意識でありました。で、その問題意識が、社会的に、認知されたケースが、一つありまして、JR東日本という大手の、鉄道会社が、提供している、カードにおきまして、この行動履歴、すなわち山本さんがどこの駅で何時に降りて、その後どこのお店で何を買ったかというようなデータが分かるわけであります。
ますが、そのデータ分析をビジネスと新しいサービスとか新しい製品を作っていくのに生かしていこうという取り組みを行おうとしたことがございました。ところがその会社は結果としてそのような取り組みを行うことができませんでした。理由はこの JR 東日本のユーザーの皆さんからそのような形でのデータの利用について了解をした覚えはない、ないしはそれは不賛成だという声がたくさん寄せられたからであります。で、この事件、このケースについてどのように理解するか、多分さまざまなポジションからさまざまな意見がありえると思いますが、日本政府としてはこれからパーソナルデータというものをしっかり活用していくということは重要だと。それは何のために重要かというと、日本において人口も減ってくる中で、豊かな経済活動を維持していく、また安全な生活を保っていく、そういう観点からは、そういうパーソナルデータも含めたデータの利活用は徹底的に進めていくべきだ、それも持続的に取り組んでいくべきだと。これが日本政府の現在のポリシーとなっています。そういうことを背景に、改正個人情報保護法においては個人情報を元にしたデータということで、なかなか事業者また人々も、心配をそれぞれの立場からするような状況を打破するためにこの匿名加工情報制度という制度的なルールを決めて、事業者の皆さんの取り組みを促し人々のデータサブジェクトのご理解も得られるような枠組みを作ろうと、こういう考え方になったものであります。で、パクさんの最後の方のご質問についてはもしもお許しいただければ佐藤さんに振りたいと思いますけれども、この匿名加工情報というものについての、言葉をどう日本語に訳するか、失礼しました、日本語には持ってきてるんですけれども、この日本語をどう英語に訳するかというところは今私どもうんと悩んでおりまして、おっしゃられたようなアノニマイゼーションというような言葉かもしれませんし、ディアイデンティフィケーションというの言葉が私どもとしてはまずは今語感が近いのではないかと思っておるのですが、これについてはさまざま議論のあるところだと思っています。なので、我々としては、このターミノロジーにつきましては ISO でも議論がなされておるようなことで、私どもも、動きをフォローさせていただいておりますので、日本の匿名加工情報制度について適切に制度設計をするとともに先ほどの EU も含めた外国の皆さんに適切にこの制度を理解していただけるような英語、これについてもしっかり作っていきたいなというふうに考えているところであります。とりあえず私からのコメント以上です。
Thank you very much. We're very fortunate tonight to have the co-chairs of the Japan-US Internet Economy Industry Forum. My good friend Kajiro-san from Hitachi, and of course Google's Yoshitaka Sugihara. And of course they're sitting together, which shows that they're working very well together. My question for them is, and the comment I'm asking, if I look at where, and listen correctly to the explanation that Yamamoto-san gave with respect to the handling of cross-border data transfers. It's pretty much what industry has been looking for here in Japan. And so I'd like to confirm that with you, or maybe get you to explain that a bit. And then, however, if I look at the situation that's developed in Korea, where there are specific data localization requirements for a wide variety of different kinds of data, how should we assess that? And I'd like to get Professor Park's comment on that as well. So maybe Kajiura-san first and Sugihara-san. We've worked on this thing for a long time, but I'm beginning to feel fairly comfortable with where Japan is on this, but I just wanted to get some confirmation.
日本側としてこのワンステップを評価しながらも日米欧だけではない韓国の話もございましたけれども個人情報保護のルールの統一に向けた、せめて調和に向けたプロセスが今後も進んでいくことを期待をしています。
今日、ちょっとお話をさせていただきます。今のお話、非常に梶原さんが上手にまとめていただいたので、リフレインすることも必要ではないと思いますので、まさに、なんですかね、一言で申し上げれば、今回のこの個人情報保護の改正については、今まできちんとディファインされていなかったことを、どういうふうにディファインしていくかということだと思います。先ほど若干出てました、追加のケースもそうですし、 実は先生から話にあった、そのリピテーションリスクをどうするのかっていうのも、企業にとって一番辛いのは、そのリスクが測れないことですね。軽度、要するに、刑罰もらうことは嬉しいことではないですけど、大体わかります。しかし、リピテーションリスクに関して言えば、どれだけ、それで傷つくのかっていうのは、もう、お金としても測りきれない。これはやっぱ困ってしまうことですので、そこをディファインしてほしいというのが、そもそもあったことだと思います。それと同時に、 もう一つやはりこれはヨーロッパが言われたというわけではなくて個人情報委員会が必要だというのはこういうその個人情報って言われるものっていうのは全てがイコールではイコールなスタンダードではないっていうか何かのコンテクストがあってそれはやっぱり個人情報なんですねとかそれはやっぱり違うんですねというようなコンテクストベースで物事を考えないと一律でできない。 まあ、例えば今さっき、アメリカ商工会長言いましたけど、終身5体のGoogleで言いますと、政治家が持っている情報と、あと、やっぱり一般市民が外に出している情報とは、やっぱり扱いが違うでしょうね、というふうに思っているわけで、一般論としてみんなそう思ってると思うんですね。ですので、そこを判断するのは一企業ではなくて、そこが、やっぱり第三者委員会というところなので、そこがクリアに、制度として出来たということは、まさに喜ばしいことではないかなと思います。 で、あと、最後に、クロスボーダーデータフローのことはもう、梶原さんが言っていただいたので、その、クラウドコンピューティングの時代、なおかつそれで、国境を越えた企業活動している私たちにとっては、どこにデータがあるか自身も実際わかんないっていうのが、投げやりにわかんないって言ってるわけじゃないですよ。それがクラウドの本質であるということを申し上げたいと というふうに思いまして、世界中に海があると、その海の中からその一部のデータを取り出せと言われても、その海のどこにデータがあるのかというのは分からない、海のどこにその魚を取り出せと言われているようなものですので、ですので、そのネイチャーから言って、そのデータは世界中で飛び回るものであって、でそこで例えば、そのローカライゼーションを求めるということは、まずそのテクノロジーに対して、まあ、安泰テクノロジー的と申しますか、まあ、そういうことがあるのであろうと、その世界中飛び回る中でも安全は図れるわけですね。なぜそこの一国にサーバーを設置してそこで守らないといけないのかっていうことがロジックとして成り立たない。でもっと言えばそれは国の中でも県とか市町村とかいっぱいあるわけですから、みんなが同じことを言ってくると各町に1個ずつサーバーを置いていかなきゃいけないような話になっちゃうので、それはどうなんでしょうねと言ってるロジックはどこにあるんでしょうねというふうに思ってしまうわけで、まあ、ちょっとこんなふうになりましたけど、ですのでやはりそれは企業にとってもあるいはみんなにとってもいいことではないし、世界中の人にとってもそれは理解できることではないというふうに思っているので、まあ、私ビジネス界からすればこの今の日本の方向性は、基本的に賛成ですが、いくつかのところで日本がもっと世界に向けて発信していかなければいけない、その日本が取った方向性はちょっと長くなって申し訳ないんですけども、今日せっかく、イギリスがエグジットしたわけなので、そのヨーロッパでその経済が、まあ、若干停滞をしていて、なおかつそういう話があるところの真似をしてそういうことをやっていく方がいいのか、あるいはやっぱりそのアジアという伸び盛り の, この地域の中で、いろんな情報、個人情報を含めて使いながら新しいビジネスを考えていった方がいいのかというのは、まあ、日本がまさにここから世界に発信していくべきなのかなと思います。
杉原さんは great politician. I'd like to have Professor Park maybe make a comment thenAnd then I want to finish with just a question from Andrew Adams. And then we'll really have to close down. Sorry, we're running a little bit over 8 o'clock, but I do urge you to stay for the coffee and networking, and you can pursue individual questions you might have. Or, you know, I'm sorry, Ishijima-san and Nakajima-san, and actually for Hayashi-san and Sato-san, couldn't get around the table, but if there are questions that you want to raise directly with any of the three speakers, please do. Professor Park?
Yeah, thank you. So now data localization and international transfer of data. I'd like to speak first with the TPP. Those methods are provided in the Charter of Electronic Commerce. And only for commercial purposes. So government data and processing of those for the government and on behalf of those governments are accepted in the e-commerce provisions. So, I mean, in general, in the TPP, data localization is prohibited. And international transfer of data is not to be prohibited, but only for electronic commerce purposes, only for the consumers of electronic commerce. And now Korea, we have the FTAs with the US and also with the EU. And according to the two FTAs,Korea is now liberalized data localization and international transfer of data for financial purposes. So financial information is now allowed to be processed abroad. And there is no data localization for the financial information. And nowWe have the cloud computing app. My understanding is cloud computing app expects private parties, I mean the use of cloud computing services abroad by private parties is okay. but still there is a strict control for the purpose of security and privacy for public institutions. So in a sense, I think data localization and the intensive transfer of data for financial purposes, Korea is quite advanced. And also, in the context of cloud computing services promotion, I think for the private sectors, Korea is now quite, I mean, in an adventurous, I mean, mode.
I want to go back to one of the comments earlier about trust and briefly raise some conclusions that come out from a couple of places. The FTC did a very good report about 18 months ago, I think now, on the issue of data brokers and made a compelling case, which unfortunately hasn't resulted in political action, that they should be given the power to oversee the operations of data brokers, which in many cases, unfortunately, they don't. It's very clear in their report, it's very unfortunate, and they should be. We had the same issue, I think, in Japan with the Benesse case, where Benesse had been subject to investigation and action following their leak. But the data brokers who purchased the information have not really been subject to anything. And this, I think, is the core of where trust is being lost. This is the violation of contact, which again was mentioned earlier. These are the places where context is being violated. These data brokers who gather huge amounts of data about huge amounts of people from huge different places, all of which violates the ideas of a context in which that data is processed. And I think this is only going to get worse as we get the Internet of Things. Because if we keep allowing data brokers to gather all this data, which is going to get richer and more detailed and more personal, then we're really going to see a problem with trust. And we can see from another area, that's advertising online, and the growth of ad blockers and the arms race between ad blockers and ad block blockers, that when people's trust is removed, they find ways around it where they can. And what we're going to see, I think, is that people are going to start deliberately poisoning the information. We already have that with unnecessary online sign-ups. People sign up as Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. If you ask them for the name and insist on the name when there's no reason for it, there's no benefit to them to give one. And this will poison the well. So it's in everybody's interest, I think, to find good rules for saying, no, these things shouldn't be just put into a single pot or a small number of pots controlled by these large companies, because that's where we're going to lose the trust.
Can I ask a quick comment, Councillor Yamamoto, and also for Mike? And then we'll have our coffee.
今のお話に付け加えることはあまりないのですが、まさに今おっしゃっていただいたお三方が言われたことも、もう背景として、つい先ほど日本で行われたその G7 サミットにおきましても、まさにデータのフリーフロー、クロスボーダーでのスムースなデータの移転というのはやはり 重要で、関係各国の目指していこうということが合意されるとともに、サイバーセキュリティの対策について、これを各国協力してしっかりやっていくことが必要だねというような話が合意されていますので、皆さんの問題意識に応えるように、日本もまた関係各国も取り組んでいくということかと思います。いかがですか。
So just really quickly about the data brokers, it is a huge problem, and part of the problem is that they're not consumer facing. So how consumers exercise control when they don't even know what's happening, all this data has been, you know, transferred among all of these companies. They sell to each other, they sell to third parties, and so where's the mechanism for control? I mean, there was a recommendation in the report for a centralized opt-out mechanism portal. Whether that's even practical, I mean, that remains to be seen, but that's a proposal, and we, as you say, we have existing enforcement tools under our general authority, but we need more tools to deal with these emerging problems in not just data brokers, but other technologies that are not consumer-facing, because normally the consumers should be able to have some control there, and in these cases, they don't always have it. With respect to the data localization issue that you raised, I like to call it the data localization paradox. The FTC does not have a policy statement on this. It's more of a trade market access issue, but I've read analyses personally that show that it seems that it would lead to better security by having these data localization requirements, but the opposite is actually true, because by spreading out the data among different countries and creating different regimes, you're creating more points of vulnerability for hackers to access that information, and you're spreading resources thin, you know, so companies can only dedicate so many resources to securing their data. And so if it's spread out among multiple countries, I think that the result is actually worse for security. And so I think it's something that countries that are considering data localization requirements need to think about very carefully about how they're putting those rules into place. That's just my personal opinion. The FTC doesn't have any policy statement on that issue. Maybe I can convince them later.
Okay, well, thank you very, very much. Can we just have a big round of applause for the panel? And I must say, as an organizer of these panels, the most frustrating thing is that we always run out of time. This is a subject that I think just as we're beginning to start to get into a real discussion, we finally have to close it down. But I'm delighted that Councillor Yamamoto, that my good friend Professor Pak, and then Mike were ready to join us. They're actually alumni of these events. This is the second time for Councillor Yamamoto, the second time for Mike, and I can't count how many times Professor Pak has been involved with these. But and I also really appreciate the panel. I'm sorry I didn't get to everyone, but I think we had a very, very fruitful discussion. And I really feel, as we've had, this is the sixth one that we've done of these panels over the last 2 years, and I can really feel that we're beginning to get a sharper focus on the issue. And of course, the governments themselves have been taking new and different types of steps. We didn't even talk about what I think is one of the really key issues, which is, you know, the role that technology can play, not only in changing the game, but also in helping us get ahead of the game. And there's a lot of interesting work that's being done in places like Google and Facebook and elsewhere on how to do that, Microsoft as well. So I want to thank everybody for coming. I please urge you to stay. We have coffee and panelists and, of course, our keynoters will be available. So thank you very much for coming.